Good morning, everyone. Today's going to be a little interesting, maybe a little different. I made an error last week that I wasn't aware that I was making, so I'm only half right and half wrong, I think. But last week I said we'll start at 9:30 today, and because we have been, that's our usual time, I wasn't aware that the church was going to start Sunday school back today at 10 o'clock. And my Sunday school class will receive a broadcast at 10 o'clock in the classroom. And so what I thought I'd do, a friend of mine, Mike Jenkins, suggested that I come on at 9:30 and tell people that today's lesson will officially start at 10 o'clock. Now, between now and 10 o'clock, I thought I may fill up some of this time with sort of a recap of where we've come from in Revelation, because there are other people that will join us eventually thinking that our lesson starts at 9:30 that are not members of the Sunday school class. They're just some friends of mine that found me online and they've been following the lessons. So I think they'll join us. So I'm gonna kill a little time until these people can come in and we can all sort of get together. Now, I'm still using my phone. I got it turned sideways for a change. So if you're having some trouble or if you're not used to seeing all of this background, that's what's going on. But we're giving that a try. And I've got something else coming next week I think will help even more. But at any rate, first of all, let me do a little time killer to tell you about this week. This has been an interesting week, more so than just the news. The news stories, I'm not going to recap all that nonsense. I will tell you that I got a little, I guess you'd say, election overload. And so Debbie and I decided we were going to get out of here and take a trip. We went to the mountains, and I wanted to share a couple of things because I want to tell you that you might want to try this. We rode up to Cowpens Battlefield, and we found this Cherokee Scenic Trail, Highway 11, and we took it. It just travels across above Greenville, headed up to North Carolina. But on the way, we stopped at the only covered bridge in South Carolina. It's very old. It's very pretty. We took some pictures, and I hope to paint it soon. Found a little diner on the side of the road called The Junction and ate some of the best fried chicken I've had in a long time. So these are the things you want to look for if you take Highway 11. Went on up to a place called Sims Chapel, which if you've heard of it or been there, you know it's on the top of a hill looking out over a cliff. It's incredible. The view, and we stayed up there and took some pictures. We were looking for fall color, and some of it was there, some of it wasn't. We went to, I think it's called Bald Rock, which I think I'm balder than the rock, but it was a beautiful view. And then went up to, I think it's Caesar's Head or Bald Mountain Park. Again, just top of the mountains, looking around, driving around. Well, there weren't a lot of people, so you know, we had it pretty much to ourselves. It was nice and cool, not hot, not cold. We also went to Mount Pisgah and drove along the parkway on Mount Pisgah, just right at the tree line. And it was just stopping at every overlook, looking out at the beauty. We saw two eagles flying overhead, tried to take pictures of those. I'm trying to remember where else we did go. We ended back up at Hendersonville, went to Chimney Rock. And on the way back, after staying up there a couple of days, we went to a little town called Tryon. Which is an interesting little place, and had a nice lunch. It was just a pleasant trip in the mountains. So if you're looking to get away, I have to tell you that the colors, they seem not to be there, but early in the morning and late in the evening, the sun hits them and they brighten up. It's really amazing. During the day, they seem dead leaves, but early morning, late afternoon, it's nice. So if you're looking for something to do to get away from all the hustle and bustle and craziness, just ride up to Cowpens, jump on Highway 11, ride up into the mountains, Sims Chapel, Baldhead Mountain, Pisgah Forest. We rode through Asheville, by the way, which Asheville's too cluttered now. I wouldn't recommend that. Been through Hendersonville and place. Like, we didn't really stop and shop a lot. We were just looking at nature and kicking back and relaxing. And that was good. We didn't have a lot of telephone or television reception at the cabin we were in, so that was good too. Had to wait till we get back to get all the news of the election and all the craziness going on. So if you're burnt out with all that, got a headache from it, I recommend the mountains. I recommend the mountains anyway for anything. But that's your 5-minute travel log. What I want to do today for the next few minutes, because like I said, some folks are joining us, is I want us to look at Revelation. We started this journey with Revelation quite a while back. I think we're up to 21 weeks now. And believe it or not, that's leaving out the first four chapters of Revelation. I did not go over the letters to the churches because the letters to the churches are really preaching material. It's messages to the seven churches of Asia Minor. But all of those seem to fit to churches today. I have preached sermons on those seven letters. They're amazing. And they do speak to us today. But where we started or where we started looking at was around chapter 4, I think it was. Chapters 4 and 5. And what I wanted to mention to you as we study Revelation, because we're going to be going on, I hope that you've heard me say this, and I hope you've gotten this idea as I look at my Bible here. Remember that John was having visions, and the visions that he were having were not always what you'd say chronological in order. He was seeing things, and then he would see something later that would sort of go back to what he's seen. In chapter 4, he's having his first vision. You know, the letters are sort of odd because you have to ask yourself, well, wait, did he read the letters? Did he see the letters? How did all that work out? But the vision starts in chapter 4, and it says he had a vision of God sitting on the throne. Now, in this vision, he is in heaven. He's looking at the throne of God. He sees God, but he doesn't see God as he is because he's too radiant to look at. He sees the rainbow and the green and the emerald. He sees the Lamb in the throne. Then he sees this Lamb, and then there's 24 elders seated around the throne. And I told you that there were various interpretations. I guess I should remind you that when I study Revelations, I try not to tell you that this is what this means exactly, because there are various interpretations of Revelation. And I'm not sure if anybody's quite got it completely correct. There's pastors out there that will tell you, oh, God revealed this to me, and I know this is what this means. I'm a little skeptical of them because they've made a lot of predictions based on their interpretation that have been wrong. So I'd say maybe that wasn't God. But there are things here that are obviously very symbolic. And remember, John was a Jewish guy writing to a Jewish audience. That's something we forget about a lot of times, is that the authors of the books of the Bible were writing to specific audiences, and so they were geared for that audience. They weren't writing for the 21st century, but it just so happens God was inspiring that what they said would speak to us in the 21st century. But I don't know many that are actually sitting down and saying, I want to write this for that group of Christians that will live in the 21st century. And that's why John sometimes seems like he's seeing things that relate more to the Old Testament than the New, because quite frankly, he is. That's his base of knowledge to draw from. That's his memory. He sees 24 elders. He doesn't explain them. We wish that he did. But he sees lightning. He sees seven flames. He sees those four creatures, which are really sort of bizarre. But even more bizarre, he sees the winged creatures, six wings with eyes all over the bodies, flying around across the heavens and above the throne. And we always think, well, these represent the knowledge of God, the all-seeing ability of God, where they're really, you know, six-winged animals with eyes, or was this the vision of John's understanding? It's sort of hard to say, because even John was having a hard time understanding what he was seeing. He sees the Lamb, and he sees him two ways. He sees the Lamb in the throne. He sees the slaughtered Lamb. Now, what that means is he sees Jesus as the Lamb that has been sacrificed, and Jesus was the perfect sacrifice of atonement. Then he sees seven eyes, seven spirits, harps, a bowl that are filled with the prayers of the saints. He hears a new song. All of that happens in chapter 4 and 5. And what it is John is giving us his vision of what heaven looked like to him. In chapter 6, we get into the scroll and the seals on the scroll. And they talk about, well, who can break the seals? And it's Jesus. And you see six seals. There's four seals of destruction. There's three seals of judgment. The fifth, sixth, and seventh seal deal with this justice. The fifth seal is about divine justice of God. The sixth seal came with an earthquake. And that earthquake is mentioned later on. And then in chapter 7, it starts off with this calmness. And from there, it goes into the idea of the vision of protection and salvation. Here, when they talk about seals, by the way, and being sealed to God, it's talking about being protected by God. If you're sealed to God, you're protected by God, and you have God's salvation. So that's what he's talking about there. We also get the four winds of destruction coming, you know, that have been held back, and the four winds come from the four corners of the earth. And with that, there's the four horsemen. We call them the four horsemen of the apocalypse. And, you know, you've got the death, famine, all that good stuff. That's really terrible. It's a horrible vision. We also see the 144,000, which is quite confusing. Like I told you, there are people today. I had one man, I don't know if I told you this, but I had one man on Facebook to see the video, and he texted me and starts telling me that he is one of the 144,000, that I was totally wrong about the 144,000, that he is totally right. He is one of them, and his mission is to seek out the other 144,000 and bring them together, and they have certain special powers. And I thought, okay, this guy seems a little crazy in a way. But then he starts presented me with this whole theology about how salvation is not given by God, it's attained by man and stuff like that. And I thought, well, he's definitely sort of off the loop when it comes to biblical theology. But there's a lot of people out there that have some interesting ideas. Some are easy to see through. I started reading the comments that came into this guy, and I was really surprised. There's a lot of people that agreed with him. And I thought, well, that's part of the problem we have today, is that people don't study the Bible. They don't even read the Bible. They sort of make up their own religion as they go along. And we talked about that. We got to Revelation 8, and we talked about the seventh seal. Now, remember, these seals are, there's seven seals, but they're open at different times from John's vision. This one comes later, and this is where there is silence. I thought that was interesting, that it starts off with silence in heaven. A lot of people try to explain this. They think, well, this is prior to the great judgment beginning. I think the judgment has already started myself, and that's what these seals are about. We get an allusion to the rapture, but John himself doesn't talk a lot about the rapture. And because of that, I think I've told you this, but I'm going to tell you again. The way John speaks of the rapture, it's almost as if he was saying the rapture is not, well, the Greek word is harpazo, and that means to be taken out. And everybody has always assumed, well, that means we'll be taken out. Well, how will we be taken out? And that's the question, because we have developed this whole scenario, and I know the, what was that series of books? And they made movies about it. My mind's suddenly blank. But we had this, I remember I was in a church one time, the pastor had this picture on the wall, and it shows people floating up into heaven, airplanes crashing, cars wrecking, piles of clothes on the ground. I never could quite figure out why, you know, if we're raptured, you know, our clothes fall off. But that was in this picture. And that's sort of the image we have of the rapture. If you read Revelation, though, you get sort of a different image. And it's not totally specific, but it certainly does allude to the idea that rapture being taken out means you're going to be martyred. Nobody wants that kind of rapture, because we're hoping to miss the tribulation. Most people are what they call pre-trib rapture. They believe that we'll be raptured before the tribulation, and so it's like, well, we'll miss all the horrible stuff. But John clearly says that some people will be left behind, and they will be martyred. Now, the question that's pretty unclear is, are the people left behind really good people staying to serve as witnesses, or were they marginal Christians, and tribulation will push them over the edge to commit their lives to Christ, and at that time they'll be martyred? It could go both ways if you just read Revelation. But there is this sort of disturbing idea that to be taken out doesn't mean to be lifted up into heaven, but our spirits will be lifted up because our bodies will be martyred here on earth because of persecution. Now, like I said, people don't like to think that way. It's a little scary for them. But in fact, it makes more sense because heaven will be filled with those who died. When you get there, John sees these people under the throne in the red robes, and they're crying out, "How long until our blood will be avenged?" And we always seem to want to say, well, that's people who were martyred way back there. But if you think about it, martyrs for Christ starts in the first century. There would have been a lot of martyrs in the first and second and third century from the Romans who persecuted Christians. But again, put it in perspective, and you may not like this, but more people today are martyred as Christians around the world than were martyred during the Roman Empire. You think, well, Brooks, that's impossible. No, it's basically just math. There were fewer Christians, and a lot of them were killed. Today, we have over 1 billion Christians in the world. And in third world countries, they are slaughtered. They are killed. Sudan is one of the worst. And nobody talks about Sudan. They say, oh, well, Sudan's doing better. The northern Sudanese were killing the southern Sudanese because they were Christians. A wholesale slaughter. In China, during the Mao takeover, I forgot what they call that too, the Long March or something. But anyway, they killed Christians. They're still persecuting Christians and killing Christians in China. In Malaysia and in places in the Middle East, we saw what ISIS did. ISIS was killing everybody, but they specifically went after one of the oldest Christian groups in the Middle East. They wanted to wipe them out. They burned them. They chopped their heads off. It was just horrible what these Christians faced. So when you read it that way, you think, well, persecution toward Christianity is on the rise. So there is a possibility that martyrdom is what we face if we stand for Christ. John talks about it here because he saw it firsthand. He saw the martyrdom of Christians under Domitian. He saw what happened under Nero. I think I also mentioned that some people think that Nero was the Antichrist, but Nero was a Antichrist. And we got into that with the number of the beast, the 666, over in chapter 14 and 13. We saw all this talk and this horrible stuff that a lot of times people like to avoid. We talked about last week about the Battle of Armageddon. I mentioned how that if you go to Israel, you can stand on the ruins of the old city of Megiddo and look east across this valley, which is basically 100, 200 miles square. And it's where the armies of the world are said to gather. And it's one of those specific things in the Bible where it literally says that in this valley of Megiddo is where the armies will gather and Christ will wipe them out. So we know that that's the place, the Battle of Armageddon. Megiddo is on one end, and that was the city of Jezebel and Ahaz, total evil people. So that sort of makes sense. I think it's rather poetic that on the western side of that valley is Megiddo, where Jezebel and Ahaz set up shop, you might say. Directly across the valley on the east side is Mount Tabor, where Jesus came back and was transfigured. Oh, well, Jesus went there. And the transfiguration occurred where Elijah and Moses come back. And when the Bible tells us here in Revelation that Jesus will come in the eastern sky, I think, well, that's rather interesting because he may come to Mount Tabor again, because that's east of the battle, because he's coming to be in that Battle of Armageddon. So, interesting things there. We were all about what was going on, and it's almost time for me to start, but I'm going to wait a couple more minutes. But you've got in chapter 14 where he saw the Lamb standing on the Mount Zion and the 144,000 who were there, and it talks about how they had his name In this, you see the mark of the beast. We talked about that a little bit. We're not sure what that mark is. Some people said, well, it's going to be 666, put on your forehead or your hand. Today, we're into all kinds of interesting things. I didn't talk about it a whole lot, but since we've got some time, I'll mention it. You know, you've got some people saying, well, this is the chip that they're going to insert under your skin, because the mark of the beast during the time of the reign of the Antichrist will be the mark that allows you to buy and to sell, and you basically won't be able to do anything unless you show the mark of this beast. But you've already got people saying, well, I'm not going to take it, I'm not going to do that. But what if it came in the form of a chip inserted under your skin that allowed you not to carry money or a debit card? Some people might think, well, that don't sound so bad, I might try that. Personally, I don't think I want to, because it does sound a little creepy. But I think people will take the mark of the beast, but I don't think it's going to be so obvious. And you say, well, Brooks, how can that be? How can these people know the mark of the beast and then accept some of this stuff? And the answer is, look at the world today. We assume, now I say we, I'm talking about us old people, by the way. We grew up with the church being a primary force in our community. We grew up going to church. We grew up studying the Bible, reading the Bibles, going to Bible school. That's who we are. But look at the generations that are behind us. I haven't done it in a while, but I was teaching religion at Northeastern Tech and at USCL here in Lancaster. And this was around 2005 through 2010. I was literally shocked at the lack of biblical knowledge that students possessed. And a lot of them claimed to be Christians. They said, well, I'm a Christian now. And we started talking about the Bible and teaching the Bible. They knew what I was talking about. And likewise, I've entertained various groups. I love to talk to people, and you know, I've been accused of being, you know, sort of mean-spirited, but I like to talk to Mormon missionaries, to Jehovah's Witness. When they come to the house, I talk to them. And most people say, no, just send them on. But I see these people as deceived and a potential for a witness, so I talk to them. And what's amazing is they're sort of hard to talk to because they don't know the Bible. They know their Bible. Joseph Smith wrote a version of the Bible. Jehovah's Witness, I forgot that person's name, but they wrote a version of the Bible. And what they did was they didn't really write a version as much as just go in and insert the things they want you to believe. The last time Jehovah's Witness came, I pointed out how they believed in multiple gods. And they said, oh, no, we don't. I said, yeah, you do. I said, read your Bible where it says that a God, they use the definite article A. I said, in the Greek, that translates as the God. I said, a God means there's multiple gods. The God means there's one. And the guy got really mad. And the young guy that was with him, he got interested. And when he got interested, the old guy that was with him, they left. Because they don't know what the Bible says, because they've been brought up to believe this sort of odd translation and interpretation. Same way with Mormonism. Joseph Smith stuck in stuff in the Bible to say that you are all going to be gods. And it's like, whoa, I'm going to become a god? Well, that sounds pretty good, unless you're a female Mormon, because female Mormons become goddesses, but their whole purpose is to have children. So, ladies, if you're a Mormon, you look forward to eternal pregnancy and giving birth. Whereas the guy, he's just sitting back being God and doing God stuff. I point that out to a couple of missionaries. One of them was interested, the other was not. The next week, they were gone. But my point is that even Christians today, people in my class that were professing Christians, didn't know the Bible. And they got upset with me because they didn't like what I taught them. I was teaching them what the Bible actually says. And when you present the truth, sometimes people get a little upset because they would much rather have their tradition. So I say that to say that when we read Revelation, we have a traditional understanding of this book. But if you read the book, it's not always what tradition says. This week, we're up to chapter 15. And it's a very short chapter. And we'll start it. And I'm looking at my clock. If you see me looking off the side, I've got a clock over there. But we're going to start that book in about 5 minutes. But if you go back and look at chapter 14, where we were last week, you see these warnings and stuff. And chapter 14 like I said, it's not falling chronologically because chapter 14 refers to stuff that was mentioned earlier, some even all the way back to chapter 7. And that's the struggle with Revelation, is that when you read Revelation, you're not reading a history book that goes year by year by year. You're reading a vision that's almost coming at you in three dimensions. John sees something in there, and then he relates it back and sees something closer to him. He sees the throne, then he sees the future, then he has a vision of these things. And the things he's seeing are happening at the same time as other things he's seeing. I hope that didn't confuse you too much, because it is confusing. That's what makes Revelation such a confusing book, because you're seeing the vision of John as he saw it, and he was confused about some of these things. I don't think he was given specific visions of things. Like, I don't think John saw helicopters and jets and tanks. Some people, I think it was Hal Lindsey, suggested that. I don't think God would do that to him, because it just blow his mind. He would just say, well, the reference, like he makes reference to these locusts, and somebody said, oh, he saw helicopters. Well, I may have never seen, you know, an Apache helicopter up close, but I've seen pictures, and I don't think I'd confuse it with a locust. Maybe, maybe not, I don't know. But John is seeing things, and he's trying to interpret them in a way that he could understand. But also you have to put it in perspective that he's interpreting it in the way that a first century Jew would understand it. And his reference point is not the Bible. His reference point is the Old Testament, or what the Jewish call the Septuagint. The Gospels had been written, and they were floating around, but they had not been put together in a book. And you had a lot of Christians writing things. So I don't think John is going to refer to these things. Now, I've talked a lot. This is going to be a long video. But as we're coming into, if you'll pardon me just a second. I talk so much, I made myself dry. I've got 9:57. I don't know if my class is all there at the church, but as I said, today is the first day that we go back into the sanctuary, I think, and we're going into Sunday school classes. So I've got this Sunday school class that they're coming together. They're going to watch this broadcast on a television in the classroom. Now, for the sake of my class, I hope you don't mind this, but if you do mind it, if you want to fire me, I understand, and get an actual person, but due to my immune system, I'm not supposed to be around crowds of people. Now, the oxymoronic thing is, I went to the mountains, I was in a restaurant, I was looking at sights, but when I go somewhere, in the restaurant, there were only six people in that restaurant, and we were social distance. I sat in the corner. When I go to these places, if there's people there, I don't usually get out of the car. And the places we went to, there was very few people. So I am socially distanced. I am staying away from people. Debbie and I were talking about going back to church. And I said, well, we can. We'd have to do the social distance thing. But I got this doctor. She fusses at me anytime I go out. She said, you shouldn't go out. I didn't know this, but my immune system is lower. The medication I'm taking every other month now, I thought was going to make me better, but actually it's still killing my immune system. So poor me. But I can stay home, or I can get out and just not go places where there's a lot of people, and I like to take drives. So that explains it. If I go to Sunday school and there's 13 people there, that's a crowd I shouldn't be in, supposedly. I could wear a mask, I could sit far away, but it's a risk. So I may not be going to come back to church right away. And I like teaching, so if you don't mind me doing this this way, if it's okay, I'd like to. But if you want somebody else to teach you, I totally understand. I may just continue doing this, putting it on Facebook. I mean, on YouTube, because I just think it's fun. Davis just sent me a note, so he wasn't going to fire me. Thanks, Davis. But anyway, it's 10 o'clock now. So if the Sunday school class has come together, we're going to look at chapter 15. And I'm going to draw your attention to chapter 15 in the Bible. Now, like I said, we ended up with chapter 14, and it was pretty gory. Chapter 14 ends with says verse 20, the press was trampled outside the city. Now, that's that wine press, and the analogy was that all these soldiers would be dumped into a wine press, and the life and the blood would be squished out of them. Pretty gory. But it says, the blood flowed out of the press up to the horses' bridles for about 180 miles. It's interesting that he says 180 miles because that valley is about 180 to 200 miles square, and it forms a bowl with a flat floor. It's a beautiful valley, by the way. But that's where this battle's going to occur. And basically it's saying it's going to be like throwing grapes in a wine press. I don't know if you're familiar with that, but in the old days they used to jump in there and stomp the wine with their feet and it'd run out. But then they got smart and they began to put a lid and they just literally cranked it down with a gear and pressed the grapes flat. And then the wine would come out a little hole on the side with the grape juice. Good for getting juice, not so healthy for grapes. They're crushed. But that's how we ended. Think about this. A valley that becomes a sea of blood. Jesus will literally wipe these people out because they stand against him. Now, chapter 15 begins this way. Then I saw another great and awe-inspiring sign in the heavens. So, he says another great and awe-inspiring sign. The first one was Jesus coming back. This is when later you'll get a fuller description of Jesus coming back on a white horse with names written on his thigh, this two-edged sword coming out of his mouth, killing people left and right. This is the Battle of Armageddon seen at a different point, a different perspective later on. With him will be the 144,000 that are behind him. But I always like to point out that we always think, oh, I want to be one of those warriors that comes with Jesus and starts killing all the bad guys. I don't think that's how the Bible tells us it's going to happen. We're not going to be warriors killing people. I don't know why Christians like to take on this mantle of being a warrior. I think it's because I read in Ephesians where we put on the whole armor of God, but that's symbolic. You know, but it makes for cool t-shirts. You got a sword and a helmet and a shield and all that stuff, and people just like that martial, macho look. But I believe what it's pretty clear in the Battle of Armageddon is Jesus does the slaying because Jesus is the righteous judge. I'm not a righteous judge. If I were one of the 144,000, even if I were with them, I would not be righteous enough to pass judgment and execute somebody. I've got sin in my life. It's been forgiven, but it's there. But the spotless lamb, the sinless one, is the one who judges. And he has the power and the right to execute, which he does. That two-edged sword is symbolic. Coming out of his mouth, people said, oh, that's gross sounding. Well, what it is saying is that the power of God, and remember this from creation, is to speak things. If you go all the way back to Genesis, in the beginning, God created. Well, what that actually says, if you translate it from the Hebrew literally, and I say we think it says because that language is very old, is he spoke things or thought things into being. It uses the term the Lord there, and it divides God even in Genesis, and people have confused about that because it uses the plural. But God is three in one. But even there, it talks about God, who is the ultimate being, and then it talks about the Lord, who is the active creation part. In the term of God, El Shaddai, the actual translation of El Shaddai is, well, it could be translated different ways, I have to tell you, but one is that God is the active God. It literally translates as God with his sleeves rolled up, which means God at work or God at war. That's Jesus. John talks about that in the beginning of his gospel when he refers to Jesus as the Logos, the Word. The Word was God, the Word was with God, the Word was God. It's saying that Logos is the active power of God. Jesus created everything because he was God's creative force. Now, I hope I didn't confuse you with that, but it's just an understanding of the Trinity and how we see it. The Spirit, the Holy Spirit, is just that. It is the spiritual force of God. And God is sort of like the mental force of God, the great omniscient being. And from that, that being exudes his creation and his spirit. And it's the Trinity. Here, this awe-inspiring sight, the Battle of Armageddon was that God's force. Here he sees seven angels with seven last plagues. Now, these seven last plagues could be the same plagues that were spoken of earlier, where you had all the seven seals and these plagues, because earlier, if you remember, we talked about these seven trumpets and the woes, and they mirror exactly what Moses did in Egypt. The plagues of Egypt are mirrored here. Let me read a little bit and I'll show it in a minute. He says, "For with them God's wrath will be completed. I also saw something like a sea of glass mixed with fire, and those who had won the victory over the beast, its image, and the number of its names were standing on the sea of glass with harps from God." A sea of glass mixed with fire. Now you say, well, that wasn't in the plagues of Egypt. Actually, it was. It's just a different description. That sea of glass could be like crystal or ice, and the fire could be coming up. And if you remember, the last plague, next to the last plague, before the death of the firstborn, it rained hail, which hit the ground and burst into flames. So that would look like a sea of glass landing and catching on fire. You see the commonality? And after that came the death of the firstborn. And that's when Egypt repented. Now, they later, we know the whole story. They later said, no, go kill Moses, and they ended up getting killed. But look what happens here. Those who had won victory over the beast in this image. So those people that survived all this, that were there and lived through the sea of glass and the fire, they're standing in it. They're standing on the sea of glass with harps from God. I love this imagery of harps. We're thinking, oh, this is musical, and choir directors love this, but it says, they sang the song of God's servant Moses and the song of the Lamb. Now, this too, we've already spoken about this. We didn't talk about the song of Moses. That's way back over there. Moses sang a song. Actually, Moses sang several songs. He sang a song before he died, and in it, I think the words are, it's here, or one of the songs is here, but the song of the servant Moses was about the Hebrew people on their Exodus. And then you've got the song of the Lamb. Well, we spoke about the song of the Lamb when the 144,000 in the last chapter, they sang a song. And if you remember, only they could learn the song. So this is very cryptic. We don't understand, what is the deal with the song? Well, he actually tells us the words of the song. I think that's interesting because this must be more of Moses' song, because you'll find it mentioned in Daniel, Isaiah, and Psalms. All this is quoted in the Old Testament. So this is probably Moses' song, not the song that only the 144,000 could learn, because we're not the 144,000, we can't learn it. But listen to this song. It says, "Great and awe-inspiring are your works, Lord God, the Almighty." Now that's like an opening statement. It's like a fanfare, basically saying, God, you're great. You're so awesome. "Just and true are your ways, King of the nations." Notice the first thing it says is just. I want to focus on that because we're talking about the justice of God. Revelations is all about justice. We have gone through a period in the church where we used to talk about repentance, then we talked about missions, and we talked about punishment. It's all down through the ages, we focused on certain things. There was a time where it was all about punishing sinners, and there was a time about always forgiving sinners, and there was a time about compassion. I think we're in a compassion age right now, where we don't even want to talk about hell or the devil. We don't want to talk about sin, seems like. We want to talk about compassion for the sinners. Yeah, be nice to sinners. Well, that's great, but one of the motivating forces for people to repent of sin, and I'm not saying this just to sound mean, but is the recognition that sin creates consequences. The consequence of sin, well, Romans said it best, the wages of sin is death. I didn't say that. The Bible said that. And if you leave that out, people don't realize the seriousness of what they're doing when they repent and surrender their lives to God, because they think, oh, God forgives me, He loves me, I'm good to go, I can go back to living the life the way I want. No, if you go back to living the life the way you want, you haven't truly repented, because to repent is to turn away from that. Do we make mistakes? Do we sin? Yes, but our primary unction is to do the will of God. And if you don't have that unction, then you don't have a relationship with Jesus. So, I know I sound like a stump preacher back from the good old days in the hills, but maybe I am. I think it's important that people recognize that sin is a sickness that we have to rid ourselves of. It's not a tennis ball we can just bat around when we feel like it. We all sin. We all fall short of the glory. That's the Bible too. But you got to recognize that God is just and true. Those two things together tells me this. God will see our sins. He will hold us accountable. Christ died for our sins, so we are forgiven. That's the good news of the gospel. It's also the mystery that we become adopted as children of God. But it still talks about a certain level of accountability. It could be self-imposed. I think about going to heaven and getting in heaven and finding that certain people aren't there and realizing that if I had done more, maybe they would have been saved. And suddenly heaven, instead of being its joyous celebration, it becomes a place of guilt and shame, and I may feel ashamed. I already know. I think if I stood before God today, I'd try to crawl under the carpet, because I think I don't deserve your grace. I don't deserve what happened to you for me. I don't know if I'm going to be one of those people that jump up and down in front of God like a cheerleader. I think I'm going to be one of those people who kneel down and say, I'm so sorry for failing you. And I think I'm going to be crying. Yep, big boy cries, tears. But I just imagine that because, well, the Bible says that at some point Jesus is going to wipe the tears from our eyes. So I think there'll be a bunch of us crying, because with truth and justice comes full knowledge. God knows everything. He knows what we thought, what we've done. And He is truthful. He's not going to say, oh, come on in. I know you didn't mean it. You didn't even do it. It's not going to be that way. He's going to tell us the truth. And people don't want the truth. The 2 Thessalonians talks about during the time of the Antichrist, that's going to be the first thing to go. They will be haters of truth. And that makes sense, because truth brings with it guilt for some people. Because when they face the truth of their life, they feel guilty. Well, they don't want to feel guilty, so they just want to brush that aside. That's why we have religions today. I shouldn't say religion. We have denominations today that say that there is no hell, there is no Satan. Well, that's very convenient. Let's just get rid of the parts of the Bible we don't like. Let's keep that heaven, streets of gold, forgiveness, love. But let's get rid of all that justice, punishment, truth stories. The song goes on. Verse 4, he says, Lord, who will not fear and glorify your name? Well, again, some people said, oh, that's not fear, that's respect. Well, no, it's fear. Who will not fear? Because you stand before perfection, and all your imperfections are seen. And in that, we glorify God, because we see that as good as we thought we may have been, He's better. He deserves the glory. He's done all the work. For you alone are holy. And that's another interesting thing. We are called to be holy and righteous. And I've known people that have claimed that. When you work in the church, you run into all kinds of people. But I've known friends, actually, that have said, I have become holy and righteous before God. And I thought, I wish I could say that, but I don't think I can. I've been forgiven. I have been made clean by the Spirit of God. But I don't know if I'm fully holy and righteous, because I'm still a human being and I have my weaknesses. I know that. And if we're honest with ourselves, we know that as much as we practice righteousness and try to be holy, we still have within us the sin of man, forgiven or not, sin washed away, but we are humans. We will be changed someday, Paul says, in the twinkling of an eye. I sort of look forward to that. But I go on, it says, all the nations will come and worship before you because your righteous acts have been revealed. That's another interesting thing, but I think about the Bible. People reject the Bible. People reject God. I've had conversations just literally this week where people have said, well, you know, the Bible's a myth. Yeah, it's not true. But someday God will be revealed. His truth will be revealed. His action will be revealed to people as righteous. I think when we see that, well, it says so here in Revelations, it said before, and it's going to say again, that when people are defeated, they see the power of God, they see Him coming on high, every knee is going to bow. So then you're going to have people that are sinners, you know, if I can. In verse 5, it says, after this I looked, and the heavenly temple, the tabernacle of testimony, was opened. Now, a couple of things there that might confuse you. The heavenly temple, also known as the tabernacle of testimony. Again, John's a Hebrew, writing from Old Testament context. The tabernacle of testimony literally was Moses' tabernacle, the tent. It says the tabernacle. I think in one version of the Bible, it does say that the tent of confession or something. It's not in this Bible, but it translates as tent. And what he's talking about, he's saying that the tabernacle will be there, the holy place. It will be called the temple because later the tabernacle will be replaced with a temple. And there's going to be a temple in heaven. Now, in this temple or tabernacle, a lot of things happen. It is the mercy seat of God. So God is in this temple. His throne is in there. So we're back to chapter 4, looking at a vision of in heaven, seeing the temple of God, God sitting on the throne. But it says, out of the temple came the seven angels with the seven plagues, dressed in pure white linen with golden sashes wrapped around their chest. So we went backwards again. Here's those seven angels we talked about that had seven plagues. They had this seal broken. And they've got the seven plagues, and they've already released these. So are they going to release them again? No, it's not a re-release. It's just a continuation of what we left before. They'll do this. It is the time of judgment. And what John is doing, he's sort of jumping around from scene to scene. So here we are. They came out of the temple. In that temple, they received this power from God because God's in the temple. In verse 8, we'll see that where it says the temple is filled with smoke from the glory of God. But let me go back to verse 7. One of the four living creatures gave the seven angels seven golden bowls filled with the wrath of God who lives forever and ever. Now, if you read that, it's like, oh, so they've got seven bowls. Probably the same thing it's talking about when it says the seven angels with the seven plagues. Well, down below, those seven bowls are what the seven plagues are in. So you're not seeing different things. You're seeing the same thing viewed differently because it's like the power of God is given to these seven angels to bring the seven plagues. One of those creatures literally handed them the bowls with the seven plagues. Now, what were the creatures? Remember, there was a bull and an ox. There was a leopard and a bird, eagle. All of these represent the power of nature to the Hebrew people. And that represents the power of God. So it would be only fitting that one of these creatures has the power to pass that power to them. And it's about power being passed to power. And this is part of the judgment. They're going to pass these plagues out on the earth. These plagues will coincide also again with the plagues of Egypt. Now, where was it? Oh, verse 8. Then the temple was filled with smoke from the glory of God and from His power, and no one could enter the temple until the seven plagues of the seven angels were completed. Now, this is a direct throwback to the Old Testament. When God came to earth, let's go back to the first appearance for the people. The first appearance was in a burning bush to Moses. But the first appearance of the people is at Mount Sinai. They knew God was on Mount Sinai. How? it lit up in fire and smoke came down. A cloud came down over the mountain. God was in the cloud, and that meant that God was on the mountain. It was a cloud or smoke from the fire of God being there. It's a very scary thing because God says nobody's to touch the mountain or you'll die. And it's like if I saw a mountain burning on top of it with smoke, I don't think I'd touch it either. But now the tabernacle is where God resides. Not on top of the mountain. Now he's in the tabernacle at the mercy seat. And when he's present, the whole thing fills up with smoke and fire. Now, is it literal smoke and fire? Maybe so. But it could be just a vision, because this whole thing is a vision, remember, where he's seeing this imagery of the presence of God, which in the Old Testament is always represented with smoke and fire. So, again, I can't tell you for sure, because when I read Revelations, I do it two ways. I read it as a literal text. Everything is real. And then I go back and I read it again, and I think, this could be symbolic. Symbolic that it's not really smoke and fire. It's symbolic the power of God. And if you were to see it, the closest thing to seeing the power of God would be a raging fire with smoke. It's a good analogy because I don't know if you guys have been around fires a lot. It's become real popular, you know, sit in your backyard with a fire pit and everybody likes to look at the fire. Fire is fascinating. But go and look at some of the pictures of forest fires out west. There's some pretty dramatic scenes because you see entire walls of flame. And that flame, you know, it's something, the most amazing thing is when you see a fire tornado. And just imagine that swirling mass of flame lapping up into the sky. You can't get close to it. It would literally incinerate you. And you suddenly begin to see the awesome power of fire. So when they see the awesome power of God, the only thing they can relate it to, because these people, you know, they didn't have a Chevy Corvette with the 427 engine in it. They didn't have shotguns and missiles and all that stuff. They had nature. And one of the most awesome things in nature they saw would be a huge fire. Yeah, think about, there weren't volcanoes around them. There were some in the ocean. One of them erupted in, you know, in Sardinia, is that it, where it erupted? But what they did see was fire. And it's like fire is hot, it's destructive, it's consuming, it's transforming. So that would be a great analogy for God. So I think that's what he's seeing. He's seeing this destructive, consuming, transforming power of God. And he's calling it smoke and fire. Really, it's fire and smoke. Now, I'm getting a little low on time, but I did want to go on into chapter 16 a little bit. Well, probably I may get through this real fast because chapter 16 moves pretty fast. It is it starts off, I heard a loud voice in the temple saying to the seven angels, go and pour out the seven bowls of God's wrath on the earth. And so what we have in this chapter is these angels are getting ready to pour out these plagues on the earth. So verse 2 says, the first went and poured out his bowl on the earth, and severe, painful sores broke out on the people who had the mark of the beast and who worshipped his image. So these people who've been following the beast are going to suffer boils. Again, you'll find that in Egypt. The second bowl poured out his bowl into the ocean, or the sea, and it turned to blood like that of a dead person, and all life in the sea died. Imagine pouring, look at what happened in Egypt. Moses touched the Nile, it turns into blood. First thing happened when it turns into blood, everything dies because fish need oxygen. They don't breathe air, they breathe it through the water. And if the water is contaminated with blood, they don't get oxygen, they die. And you have this big death. And that's what happens here. Not to get too far into this, but have you ever thought about the earth is 70% water? And the oceans are in constant motion. We go to the beach. When I was a kid, I liked to ride the waves. I body surfed because I had this really great body to surf with. But so I'm going to the ocean and there's waves. Well, imagine if there were no waves. We sort of saw that in Israel. Mike, Debbie, I can't remember if Diane jumped in. I think she did. But we all jumped in the Dead Sea. And you know what? There's one interesting thing about the Dead Sea, other than the fact that it's the Dead Sea full of salt and you float. There are no waves in the Dead Sea. I mean, we had to make our own waves. But you stand there and the water is just flat. If there were nobody in that thing, it would look like a sea of glass. Nothing moves it because it's dead. And nothing in it is alive because it doesn't move. You dump all this salt into it, it's stationed. Now you get a lot of healthy mud if you're into mud baths. But picture that, if the oceans died. There was a scientist, when I was a kid, we read in our science book about how if we didn't have the moon, the earth would die. And I said, why? Because it is the moon, gravity, that stirs the ocean, literally the tides and the waves. And if you don't stir the oceans, they get stagnant and everything dies. And I thought, well, that's amazing. The moon serves a purpose. Other than reflect light, it literally stirs the ocean to keep life going. Well, here, oceans turn to blood, so everything dies. Think about it. No more fish. People starve to death. The third angel poured out his bowl into the rivers and the springs of the water, and they became blood. Now, people like to look at this and they try to figure it out scientifically, but it's true. If the ocean turns to blood, the next thing you know, the land water is going to turn to blood because of evaporation. All that's carried over. But anyway, I heard the angel of the water say, you are just the Holy One who is and who was, because you have passed judgment on these things. Because they poured out the blood of the saints and the problems you have given them blood to drink. They deserve it. I heard the altar say, yes, Lord God, the Almighty, true and just are your judgments. He makes a comparison, say, they poured out the blood of the saints. We're pouring out the blood into the oceans, and now they're going to drink the blood. And they deserve it. I love that part. It says they deserve it. Yeah, and this is one of the judgments of God. They get what they deserve. The fourth bowl poured, or the fourth angel poured out his bowl on the sun. It was allowed to scorch people with fire, and people were scorched by the intense heat. So they blasphemed the name of God who has the power over these plagues, and they did not repeat and give him glory. Well, that makes sense too. Imagine people when they get hurt. I mean, we do it. You ever hit yourself in the hand with a hammer when you're nailing something? It's the first thing you say is, wow, that felt so good. Oh, gee, that was great. I'll do it again. No, a lot of times we say things we wish we hadn't said. A lot of times things come out that, you know, don't normally come out. Pain elicits this. It elicits defiance and anger. And that's just what happened here. These people were scorched by the fire. And here again, I love when scientists comes and read the Bible and they say, oh, well, this is sunspots. Well, it could be. We're going through, well, actually, we've already gone through a period of high-intensity sunspots. Everybody says, oh, the ozone layers disappear. We'll be burned up with all these. Well, we get sunburns all the time. But this is something different. This is the fire that's going to have a greater intense heat. Going to burn us up. And the people don't repent from this. They blame nature because they don't believe in God. The fifth angel poured out his bowl on the throne of the beast, and its kingdom was plunged into darkness. Remember the darkness in Egypt? Again. People gnawed their tongues because of their pain and blasphemed the God of heaven because of their pains and their sores, but they did not repent of their works. Now, look at the fifth bowl and go way over here to the first one, and these are the people with the painful sores. Now, they're in darkness. There is something about darkness for some people that creates chaos. People like to do bad things in the darkness, and so they're put in darkness. When they're put in darkness, they're even more afraid. Now you're in darkness, and you're in pain, and it's such a vision of they gnawed their tongues. You ever bite your tongue and gnaw on it? But again, they didn't repent. The sixth bowl is poured out on the river Euphrates, and its water was dried up to prepare the way for the kings from the east. Then I saw three unclean spirits like frogs coming out of the dragon's mouth, from the beast's mouth, and from the mouth of the false prophet. For they are demonic spirits performing signs who travel to the kings of the whole world to assemble them for the battle of the great day of God, the Almighty. Now, this battle, by the way, this is the Battle of Armageddon being referenced here. People say, oh, no, this is a totally different battle. No, it's not. This is where I'm telling you, John saw things sort of, and he wrote about things that were sort of out of line. These seven bowls are the seven plagues that we've already talked about in chapter 14. This battle is the Battle of Armageddon, and who's going to be in it? Well, the kings from the east. The river Euphrates dried up, so to prepare the way for the kings from the east. Now, who are the kings from the east? Al Lindsey wrote a book called Late Great Planet Earth. Everybody used to treat it as a gospel. I'm not sure if he's right about it. But they talked about the millions of men. They said, well, that's China. And Gog and Magog, that's China and that's Russia with millions of men. Well, it could be. The Bible actually says, though, that it's probably Iran and what we call Asia Minor today. You think, well, that's not a lot of people. Well, there's quite a few. Iran's got a million-man army and the Republican Guard. They don't call them that anymore. But it could be Iran, and it could be Asia Minor. Asia Minor is ruled by a guy who's maybe certifiably crazy, Erdogan. And a lot of people said he does things like the Antichrist. He had a giant holograph of himself projected for Parliament. And in the Parliament, he healed a woman. Now, we didn't hear a lot about that on the news because people think, well, that's just nothing to hear about. But that was big news for the people in Asia Minor. They thought, we've got a healing prime minister who projected himself up into the sky. You know, it did sound a little Antichrist. But anyway, you've got this going on, the Battle of Armageddon. And in verse 15, Jesus speaks. He says, look, I'm coming like a thief. Blessed is the one who is alert and remains clothed so that he may not go around naked and people see his shame. Verse 16, so the assembled kings at the place now called in Hebrew Armageddon. Told you, Battle of Armageddon right there. So that battle's about to happen. Now, the seventh bowl is poured out. We've gone through people. We've gone through oceans destroyed, the water destroyed on land. We've gone through fire destroying everything. We've gone through the beast in the darkness. And now we've gone through the battle of the Armageddon. Here's the seventh bowl. Look what's left. In the seventh poured out his bowl into the air. And a loud voice came in the temple from the throne saying, it is done. There were flashes of lightning, rumblings, the peals of thunder. A severe earthquake occurred like none other since people have been on earth. So great was the quake that the great cities split into three parts and the cities of the nations fell. Babylon the Great was remembered in God's presence. He gave her the cup filled with the wine of his fierce anger. Every island fled, and the mountains disappeared. Enormous hailstones, each weighing about 100 pounds, fell from the sky on people, and they blasphemed God for the plague of hail and because the plague was extremely severe. Now, this is Judgment Day, folks. And that's what he's talking about. This poured out on the air could be twofold, depending on how you interpret it. People say, oh, the lightning and the thunder. Well, that could be part of this, but it could also be the voice of God. Because when the voice of God said, it is done, remember, God's voice sounds like thunder and lightning. When he's on the throne, he was surrounded by thunder and lightning. The voice of God, like the voice of rushing waters or many people singing or thunder. So that could be that when he said, it is done, it was like a sound that just wrecked the world. Creates an earthquake. Now look at this earthquake. This earthquake right here is the same earthquake that was referred to way back there. So John's seen this earthquake. Now he's getting another look at it. In this earthquake, the great city was split into three parts. Now this one is a little bit confusing because most people think the great city is Jerusalem. You will find some people say that the great city is the city of the Gentiles. So what is the great city of the Gentiles? I hate it when people say, oh, that's New York. Well, everybody wants New York to be Babylon, and they want to be the great city of the Gentiles. Because New York is evil, because of all the banking. But do you know that New York is no longer the world center of banking? London is. There's more banking going on in London than New York, so maybe it's London. Or more than likely, it could be Rome. Because at the time this was written, that was the great city. It says Babylon the Great was remembered in God's presence. Well, could be Babylon, the great city. Now, the empire of the Babylonians is gone. The empire of Babylon is gone. What's where Babylon was today modern day Iraq. In those days, it would have been in the empire of the Parthians, the Scythians, nomadic-like tribes, very good warriors, but they weren't really what we call domesticated, living in cities. So this could be a vision of the future. And then that future is going to be the great city. So it doesn't specify. Is it going to be Rome? Is it going to be Jerusalem? Could it be a Babylon risen again? You know, Saddam Hussein tried to rebuild the old city of Babylon because he saw himself as the reincarnation of Nebuchadnezzar. But he was crazy. But anyway, look at what happens after that. He gave her a cup filled with the wine of his fierce anger. Now, there's that analogy of wine again. Go back over. Armageddon in the Valley of Megiddo was like the giant wine press. And that wine is the blood of the people who challenged God. So he's saying, I'm going to give them a cup filled with the wine of my fierce anger. In other words, they're going to be drinking the blood. And it's the same blood they were drinking over in verse 4. Remember, the third bowl was the rivers and springs, and they became blood. And these people have said, because you passed judgment, because they poured out the blood of the saints, you have given them blood to drink. That's in verse 6 over there. So, referencing back to verse 6, they're going to be drinking the blood of the martyrs. Then, every island fled. Now, the fleeing of the islands, they're not going to get up and leave. I always remember that guy in Georgia. I shouldn't even say this, but it's one of the most bizarre things I ever saw. Representative Johnson in Georgia's meeting for these generals, and they were talking about putting a Marine base on Guam. And this guy literally had a question. He said, but if you put all those Marines on the north side of the island, won't the island tip over? I heard that, and I started laughing. I thought, oh my gosh, he's serious. And the generals were looking at each other like, you know, is this guy kidding? But he was serious. Later he said, well, he was on drugs and he didn't know what he was saying, but he said a lot of dumb things. But there was this idea that islands just float around out there and then they'll be washed away. Well, what can wash away the island? Well, tidal waves. Earthquake creates the tsunami. Tsunami is tidal wave. But more than likely what it's saying is that when this earthquake hits, there will be tsunamis and the islands around will be swamped. We've seen that before, where islands just get disappeared almost. I'm sorry, that's not a word. They almost disappear under a wall of water, and this is going to be a major wall of water. And add to that, the mountains disappeared. Well, how do we explain that? Earthquake happens, mountains crumble. This is a major natural catastrophic event. Then add to that hailstones. Okay. A lot of people have had hailstones hit your car and you have to get your car fixed and you know, you get all these little dents in it and get a paint job and they pull out the dents and stuff. But those are hailstones that are like maybe quarter size, golf ball at the worst. I lived in Texas and it wasn't uncommon to have hailstones size softballs. And they said, don't go outside. If you get hit in the head with one of these things, it'll kill you. But imagine a hailstone that weighs about 100 pounds. That's a big hailstone. And they're going to fall. Fell from the sky on people. Okay. You're walking around and all of a sudden you get hit in the head with a 100-pound rock. You'll never remember it. You'll die. But the people that saw it, look what they did. Did they run to church and repent? No. They're still stubborn. They're still tough. Because it says they blasphemed God for the plague of hail. And because that plague was extremely severe. Look at all the stuff that's happened, and it's the hail that gets them, folks. And again, I go back to Egypt. Next to the last was fiery hail. After that, the firstborn in Egypt died. And that's what got them. Now, I'm looking at the clock again. We've come to the end of chapter 16. So today, we cover chapter 15 and 16. 15 short, 16 is gruesome. But what you're seeing is, the vision that started in 14, And you had the Battle of Armageddon, all this stuff. And it even goes back before chapter 14. This is John looking at the judgment day. Now, the best way I can put this is what I did this weekend. Well, this week. When you go somewhere and you're sightseeing, I was in the mountains and I was standing on a high mountain. I looked to my left and there was ridges, it was beautiful. I looked to my right and there was this weird looking little mountain and there was a hump and then there was lake. I looked further, there was a pinnacle peak, almost perfectly conical shape. I looked out past that, there was a blue horizon line. Then I looked down below, it was just a deep cliff with trees. My point is, from the vantage point that I was at, every time I looked, I saw something different. But what I was looking at was the same scene. I want you to understand that I believe what John is writing here is he is seeing the same scene, but he's seeing different aspects of it. And sometimes it's the same thing, but he's seeing it clearer. That the business with some of these plagues, he saw the plagues. He saw the Battle of Armageddon. He saw like a wine press. Now he sees the Battle of Armageddon again, but this time he focuses on the armies that were from the east. We know these armies from the east. He doesn't tell us where. You know, I wished he did. But he is seeing in this part of Revelation, and it's going to continue on, by the way. He is seeing the judgment day. So this is not like yesterday we saw that, today we see this, tomorrow we'll see that. This is the same day. His vision, it's like he's just turning around, looking from side to side, and seeing all of this horror play out before him, and he's writing it. But he doesn't have the ability to write it chronologically because I think he's overwhelmed. I would be overwhelmed. And in this, he sees not only the events and the aspects of the events, but he's also seeing the people. Because notice in this, we get him adding the point that the people were blaspheming and cursing God because of this. Later, some will kneel and they'll repent. But right now, they're in the argument phase. They're suffering. And rather than say, praise God, they're angry at God. That's verse chapter 15 and 16. I got to stop because church is going to start in about 15, 20 minutes. So let me do this. Reminder about prayer. Davis, we've talked to Davis here, but Davis, if you haven't heard, has been moved again. I think he's going to High Point, and he has been diagnosed with COVID. Now, I think he's asymptomatic right now, but he came back positive, so they're moving him to another place to treat that. But he's going to be quarantined for the next couple of weeks. So pray for Davis. You know, Davis is a good guy, but he, I don't know, he's sort of gone through a lot. A lot of us have. I've got other people on the prayer list, but I think what we need to do is just have a word of prayer for these people. Now, I just got a message that some people missed the end. I'm not exactly sure what that means. If I got cut off, I know that I had a message come through that may have blocked out. So I apologize if we had any technical difficulties. That seems to always happen. But I guess we do the best we can. I encourage you to go to church today. Like I said, our church is going to be in the sanctuary. And people in my Sunday school class, I hope you heard some of this and I hope you got something out of it. I apologize if you didn't. But let's have a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, I come to you this time offering you our praise and thanks, God, for you are so worthy of our praise and our love and our servitude. I ask your forgiveness, God, for our weakness. I ask your forgiveness for the times that we fail you. I lift up to you the names of people on our prayer list and on the prayer list for those people that are watching today, friends and church members. Be with them as they come together to worship. May your presence be strong and mighty there, that they can be blessed by the presence of the feeling Holy Spirit. Again, Lord, I pray you be with us this day in worship, next week, and as we go forward. Be with our country as it still struggles with the election and trying to figure out what's right, what's wrong, what's fraud, if not fraud, all these questions that rack our brains and stir us. But Lord, be with us all. I pray, God, again, for forgiveness, that you would strengthen us, because we are in travailing times of struggle. But Lord, as I always pray, help us to be the people that you intended us to be, that you want us to be, that we can be your servants, that we can be salt and light in your name. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Next week, we will start at 10 o'clock. So I'll see you guys at 10 o'clock here on this, and we'll be broadcasting on Facebook Live in the classroom. For those that are watching online, tune in at 10 o'clock. I'll see you then. Thanks a bunch.